every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God. And here we go. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing His mercy and His grace. In the mansions bright and blessed, He'll prepare for us a place. When we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. When we all see Jesus, we'll sing and shout the victory. Oh Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds Thy hands have made, I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, Thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Let's sing that refrain again. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to Thee, how great Thou art, how great Thou art. Amen to that.
God is great indeed. Oh, how good it is to be together in worship, and I'm seeing some folks that I haven't seen for a long time. It's so good to have you back in God's house for us to be together. I am Pastor Joni Schilling, and on behalf of all who are worshiping and leading in worship today, I welcome you. I welcome all those who are joining us online, and we ask that you fill out the connection card online, especially if you have not worshiped with us before. So we would love to know who you are and to connect with you further. Today we are, Pastor Russ's message will be entitled, Picking Up Your Mantle. And it is based on the story of two prophets, Elijah and Elisha. And so you will look forward to hearing more and more about what it means to have that mantle passed on to the next to serve. Let us pray. God of the prophets, you have promised to be with us whenever two or three are gathered together in your name. You have shown yourself faithful to us, and you have been our friend and our guide, and you have been our strength. Help us learn to be faithful in return, beginning this day with our worship. Turn our hearts and minds to you so that this community of faith may truly be the body of Christ. in whose name we pray. Amen.
If you would please stand, if you're able, and we will join together in singing another song, our opening hymn, I Love to Tell the Story. I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know 'tis true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story, 'twill be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story, more wonderful it seems than all the golden fancies of all our golden dreams. I love to tell the story. For me, I love just the reason I tell it now to thee. I love to tell the story. And his love. I love to tell the story for those who know it best, seem hungering and thirsting to hear it like the rest. And when in scenes of sing this out. I love to tell the story. 'Twill be my theme in glory to tell the old, old story of Jesus and his love. Church, you are in rare voice this morning. You may be seated.
Good morning. Our children's message is for our children online and the child in all of us. And the other day I was hungry, and my fiance will attest that I am not much of a cook. So I wasn't sure I could handle much of anything, but pudding sounded good. And I pulled this out and thought, I don't know, I'm not sure this is even within the realm of possibilities for me. But I turned it over and looked at the directions and pour 3 cups of cold milk into a bowl, add and beat until well blended. Sounds simple enough, right? Well, anyone can do that. There are some things in life that are just that simple. We just have to be willing to follow the directions. In our story today, Naaman is a person who wanted to be healed. So he was told that in order to be healed, he needed to wash himself 7 times in the Jordan River. Sounds simple. Maybe too simple, Naaman thought. He thought that there was something more that needed to be done. That's just too easy. So at first he refused. I don't know if that sounds like anybody else's story here. Just too easy, maybe something more is required. But eventually he did it, and just like he was promised, he was healed. We often face things in life, and we are willing to try anything, anything except the simple thing that God's word tells us to do. God's word has the solution to all of life's problems. And if we will follow those directions, sometimes it is just that simple. Will you pray with me? Dear God, help us to not look past the sometimes simple answer when it comes from you. Allow us to be okay with not overcomplicating matters because we can't rest in your goodness. We know that when we follow your directions, you will provide. In Jesus' name, and all of God's children said, amen.
And now we're going to join together in our song of prayer preparation. O Master, let me walk with thee. O Master, let me walk with thee in lowly paths of service free. Tell me thy secret, help me bear the strain of toil, the fret of care, in hope that sends a shining ray far down the future's broadening way, in peace that only thou canst give with thee, O Master.
Master, let me walk with you. Let me go the path that you would call us to walk. Maybe that path takes us down a lowly path of service where we are stretched out of our comfort zone. Lord, we want to walk with you. We want to be faithful to that walk as you are faithful to us. Lord, you are the God of the still small voice, as well as the rushing mighty wind. And so we thank you, Lord, for not only your power, but that still place where you tell us your secrets and help us to deepen our understanding of who you are and who we are called to be. Lord, we confess that sometimes we're so busy talking to you when we pray that we fail to be silent, to listen. And so now let us pause to simply be and to simply listen. Lord, we give you thanks for the way that you have been present throughout this past year to help us to endure challenge, to see and experience your presence and your power at times when we felt so weak. Lord, we thank you for renewed connection and presence with one another in this faith community. We thank you for the hope that you have restored in us, that we are now able to see your plan a little more clearly. Lord, we pray that you would be with all those who are gathered today, both online and in person, who are still awaiting the fulfillment of their hope, still waiting for healing, still waiting for answers, still waiting for peace. And while they wait, may this body hold them up, undergird them with the power of a faith community, and may we all grow more and more close to you and more in your likeness. In the name of Christ, who taught us to pray, let us pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
John, I'm going to stay on the pulpit mic this morning. Good morning. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Russ Titchener. I'm honored to be one of the pastors here at Maumee United Methodist Church. And this past Tuesday, we were with our worship group. Our worship group consists of Pastor Joni, but she was on vacation this last week. It also consists of Jerry Kidd. It consists of Kathy Sweeney. And it also consists of Carrie Patrick Clark, along with the illustrious youth director, Zach Phillips. And so as we moved into planning this past week, our services for today, I described what the theme of the message was and what the scripture passage was. And Zach kind of got one of those little kind of worry lines in his forehead and was kind of going like this, right? And he says, he kind of looks at me funny. He says, that sounds a lot like my sermon from last week. To which I said, exactly. Because last week, all I heard from all of you was, oh my God. Goodness, did he preach a good sermon. And if I heard it once, I heard it, let's say, 435 times, right? Over and over and over again. In fact, I heard it so many times that I thought, why not just continue to ride the wave into this week? Truth be told, last week was a great sermon. A sermon that Zach had titled, The Baton. And Zach focused on the importance of handing off our faith to others. And in particular, because last Sunday was graduation Sunday, Zach focused on the importance of handing off our faith to the next generation. Just like a runner in a race who hands off the baton to the next runner in the relay. Today we will continue on that journey as I examine really what happens next. What happens after we hand off the baton, or after someone hands us the baton of faith? What happens to us as we examine in our lives how we run this race that God has called us to? In a sermon that, as Pastor Joni has already said, is titled Picking Up Your Mantle. So let's take a moment, let's pray, and then I'll move into today's sermon. Heavenly Father, you have called us to a race, if you will. You've called us to a place in our lives where we can accept you as our Lord and Savior. And from there, Lord, it's a race to the finish line. Lord, you give us all sorts of instructions on how to do that properly. And today we'll unpack some of those. And so help us to truly see this. Help us to accept the challenge that you have given to each of us. Help us to, as we'll learn in a little while, pick up the mantle that you have presented to us and run the race well. Lord, bless us today. We love you and we pray this in your name, Jesus. Amen. In the movie Glory, Matthew Broderick plays a true life character. This is a movie that's probably, I don't know, it's probably 20 years old now. But it's about Colonel Robert Shaw, a true story about Colonel Robert Shaw. He's a Civil War colonel who had volunteered to lead the first company of black Civil War or black Northern troops against the South. In a scene from the movie, Colonel Shaw has volunteered his company of men to be the first to move in and to attack Fort Wagner. Now, Fort Wagner was the fort that protected Charleston Harbor, and so it was heavily, heavily fortified. And Shaw knew that the casualties, if he volunteered his force, would be high. The night before the attack, Colonel Shaw's commander, General Strong, stood before the troops, and he addressed Shaw and his men in particular. And pointing to the flag bearer, the general said, "If this man should fall, who will volunteer to pick up the flag?" And stepping forward, Colonel Shaw said, "I will." Speaking words that truly demonstrated his commitment to the cause. You see, long before that moment had arrived in Colonel Shaw's life, he had decided to join the army, he had gone through training, he had received his commission. But it was only then, only now, that he would reveal his commitment to his country through his actions on the battlefield. In the same way, for those of us who have received this baton of faith that Zach talked about last week, for those who have received that, we have made our confession. We have received our baptism. And we are now revealing our commitment to Christ by putting our faith in action. For Colonel Shaw, his commitment to his country was demonstrated through his willingness to say yes, both to word and action, however he could best serve his country. And for us, our commitment to Christ is demonstrated through our willingness to say yes to our faith in action, however we can best serve God. That is the reality that we are saying yes to when we receive that baton of faith. That when we place our trust and faith in Jesus Christ, it is a commitment not only of heart and mind, but a commitment of the will through our faith experience to put our faith into action, a will that is driven by a faith in God. You know, sometimes I think when we look at that transition, you know, I my head and heart are lined up with God. A faith that is vital of our salvation and a faith that changes our lives. And yet when we start to look, how do we live that out in different places? Sometimes, as Bethany's illustration this morning, it's just so simple, but sometimes it can seem so hard. We need almost a new picture, if you will. I can remember when I was, I probably started when I was, I don't know what grade, I put on my first goggles. I was in the swimming pool. I can remember we had gone on a vacation with my parents, and we had stayed in a motel. When you're traveling and you don't get to stay in a motel a lot as kids, you know how that is. The first thing you want to do is get down to the pool, right? It's kind of like Lynn going to Lakeside, right? Let's go to the pool, right? And I remember going to this pool, and my parents had bought me these goggles, and so I was going to go under and explore. And as I went under, one of the first thing I saw right there in front of me was this giant fish. And so I come out of the water and up the steps, and I went, and I was looking, and then I realized that the fish was painted on the side of the wall, right? And so I cautiously went back down into the water and put my goggles back on. But that experience and many others really whet an appetite that someday I wanted to learn how to scuba dive. And in high school, I was a high school junior, I think, and took a scuba diving lesson and then went down to Florida and went for a week with people that were much older than me, right? They were watching over me all week. But on the outside, looking at the horizon, driving over or boating over the top of the water, and we get, you know, 3-4 miles out, and in the world, you thought you knew it, but then you would jump into the water and you put on the goggles, and all of a sudden, everything changed. It was a whole new world, right? There were fish and schools of fish and beautiful coral reefs and sea anemones and clownfish swimming through those and urchins and all sorts of God's creation right there, just below the surface, that had just been opened up to us because we put on these masks and it allows us to see a whole new world. I think that's what our faith does. We take the baton and we really don't know what it's going to be like. And then we start dipping our toe in the water and we start to put on a mask and all of a sudden we go, oh my goodness, this is incredible. But I don't think it's that way at first. I think at first we kind of pause. In our scripture passage from this morning, I think we're seeing a person pause for just a moment. Our passage is about one of the great prophets in the Old Testament and his sidekick soon to be. It is the prophet Elijah and how he taps his future successor, Elijah. Now, I don't know why God couldn't call them Bob and Pete, right? But he didn't. He called them Elijah and Elijah. Okay, so we're going to be doing this all Sunday morning here, okay? But in our scripture passage, just prior to today's passage, in 1 Kings 17, 19 through 19, if you don't have anything to do this week, look that up. It's a great story, really 17 through 20. 1 Kings 17 through 20 tells this entire story. Many of the people in Israel at the time had turned away from God. They had turned instead to worshiping the false god Baal because their king, King Ahab, an evil king, had turned the people away. Him and his wife Jezebel had started to worship different gods and in doing so had led the people down a false path. And so Elijah had commanded Ahab to gather the people on Mount Carmel along with 450 prophets of Baal. As Elijah set up probably the greatest contest in history to answer the question, who is the true God? And in an incredible contest, after God wins in dramatic fashion, so you'll go back and read about the contest, right? Elijah destroys the prophets of Baal. And fearing retaliation from Queen Jezebel, Elijah runs into the desert, where he's sustained by this miraculous food and water being given to him. And for 40 days, he travels to Mount Horeb or to Mount Sinai, where in a cave he meets God. And there in that cave, he encounters the living God through the whisper of a wind. God telling him, among other things, to go into the desert of Damascus to find an anointed man named Elijah so that he could replace Elijah as the prophet. And that is the story that we're going to look at today, the story that picks up in 1 Kings 19, starting in verse 19, states this. So Elijah went and found Elijah, son of Shaphat, plowing a field. There were 12 teams of oxen in the field, and Elijah was plowing with the 5th team. Elijah went over with the 12th team. Elijah went over to him and threw his cloak across his shoulders and then walked away. Elijah left the oxen standing there, ran after Elijah and said to him, first let me go and kiss my father and mother goodbye, and then I will go with you. Elijah replied, go back, but think about what I have done to you. So Elijah returned to his oxen and slaughtered them. He used the wood from the plow to build a fire and roast their flesh. He passed around the meat to the townspeople, and they all ate. Then he went with Elijah as his assistant. Now, God had told Elijah while he was still in the cave that not all the people of Israel had turned against him. That there were a group of people that were 7,000 strong that were still righteous, that were still worshiping only God and had not started to worship Baal. No doubt Elijah was part of this group of believers. Somewhere along the way, he was nurtured in the faith, most likely by his parents. And through that nurturing, as we had said earlier, the baton of faith had been passed on to him. And so it was that Elijah shows up and confers upon Elijah God's invitation to become the next great prophet by throwing his cloak, or what is sometimes translated as a mantle. So a mantle and a cloak are the same thing. By throwing this cloak or this mantle over his shoulders, showing that God had chosen him. And so it is at that moment that Elijah starts to understand that that the rubber needs to meet the road, right? Or is meeting the road. What is going to happen with this faith that he has confessed, and how is it going to be lived out in his life? God, through Elijah, is offering Elijah a ministry opportunity, if you will, offering his cloak or his mantle that will, if he chooses to pick it up, will signify his willingness to accept God's offer and put his faith into action. Now, no doubt Elijah's request is large. Elijah is saying, come with me. Leave your mother and father. Leave your family and your friends. Leave the only type and style of life that you've ever known. Prophets weren't known for long life. People killed the prophets. Elijah is telling Elijah, leave this place of comfort and safety and come with me into a life that faces much danger. And in response, Elijah seems to pause. I probably would have. Perhaps even thinking, let me think about it. First, let me go up and tidy some things that are at home. Let me kiss my mom and dad. Let me hug some friends. Let me fix a meal and have a supper. Let me pack a bag. Let me do some things that perhaps I can do to think through this process. And Elijah tells him, okay, go ahead. Go ahead. But think about what I have done to you. In other words, think about this opportunity and who it is that is calling you. Decide what you will do with your faith and how you'll put it into action. Decide if you will pick up the mantle that God has placed in your path. And indeed, Elijah decides. He returns back to slaughter the oxen and destroys the plow, setting it on fire, and that wood then cooks the meat. And really, he is testifying, right, that he's cutting ties with his old way of life, cutting ties with the fact that he was a farmer who needed an oxen and a plow because he no longer does, and making a public confession, if you will, and really perhaps a covenant, if you will, to say, here was my old life that I'm now destroying so that I can be on with Elijah in my new life. Elijah went with Elijah as his assistant, we are told, and followed him probably for around 6 years before the great event of Chariots of Fire that we will read about at a future date. As I said earlier, each of us who have picked up the baton of faith are offered this mantle of God. Our mantle is simply an invitation to follow Jesus wherever he might lead, which simply means that we are willing to put our faith into action in order to give God the glory in all that we say and do. The Apostle Paul gives us an image of how we might live into this when he says this in Colossians 3. He says, since God chose you to be the holy people he loves, you must clothe yourself with tenderhearted mercy, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Make allowance for each other's faults and forgive anyone who offends you. Remember, the Lord forgave you, so you must forgive others. Above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds us all together in perfect harmony. And let the peace that comes from Christ rule in your hearts. You know, as Bethany was giving that illustration once again with the simplicity of instructions that were on that pudding, picking up our mantle is really the same type of, I think, experience. It's not a complicated process. It's not a confusing process. Can it be a challenging process? Absolutely. But it's simple in a way that it's understood and the way God intends it to be. Right? It is simply putting our faith into action by bringing glory to God in 1,000 different ways. At the moment we accept the baton, God is handing us a mantle. And he's just saying, follow after Jesus and do things like Jesus would do them. I think sometimes we're afraid because we're thinking that God may show up and say, I want you to become the next prophet like Elijah did with Elijah. But I don't think that that is usually how God works in our lives. There are people like Moses and Paul and the apostles and people who in the history of the church, in the history of our faith, that God used to move forward the faith for specific and very purposeful reasons. But I think the vast majority of the time, God is simply calling us to be faithful right where we are, right where we're planted, in very simple ways. This past week, I was watching TV, and I was watching a story about St. John's baseball team and how they made it to the Final Four, I guess the first time, right, Bethany? First time, so Bethany works at St. John's, right? And so it was like this big celebration, and they had pictures. I think we have a picture. Yeah, this is the picture of last weekend, not yesterday, but last Saturday afternoon as they had won that championship, and they were just like on fire, right? They were excited about their win. But I don't think it was the big news of St. John's Jesuit school from last week that made that probably headline story. That was really the really, really big news. You see, I think the big news came here. This was the next morning, right? And most of their baseball team had come to another baseball game. A baseball game, and I don't know what it was. It was an important game for their young bat boy. And they had got out of bed after this incredible win the day before and pulled themselves to the field to sit in the stands to cheer on this young bat boy so that he would know that he was surrounded by a team that supported everyone, right? An incredible act of kindness. Now, some might say they should have been in church because that was probably right during my service, right? But I believe that demonstration of kindness is what it is to live out our faith. And exactly that is what our church service should be all about. Right? St. John lost last night's Final Four game when they went in, right? Their first game against Cincinnati Elder. But of all the cheering that took place, over the last 2 weeks, I believe the loudest was by Jesus last Sunday morning when he saw all those boys show up to support their bat boy. When the St. John baseball team put their faith in action, and through that, God was glorified. Michelle and I were down in Marysville this past Friday to close on a condo we were purchasing, and we were early. They wanted us there at 10:30, and I was going to show up early. She goes, "We're not showing up early." I said, "Okay, fine." So we stopped at a convenience store, Turkey Hill convenience store, I think, and we had to go to the bathroom. We wanted to buy some drinks, and so we were, like, looking around, and we ran into this lady. Her name is Chris. I'd seen her earlier as soon as we walked in the door, and she was, like, bebopping around the store. She was busy smiling and greeting customers and helping people in the store, and she came over to us, and told us, she goes, "Oh, it's Friday." I said, "Friday." She goes, "Friday means it's free coffee, free cappuccinos." And I said, "No way." And she said, "Yes way," right? And so we grabbed our two free cappuccinos, but feeling guilty that we had used the restroom, got the free cappuccinos and a coffee. I mean, that doesn't seem right. So we bought a couple of bottles of water on our way out, right? And as we were standing behind the checkout or waiting for her to check us out, she was working with another man who was buying lottery tickets. Have you ever waited behind somebody who's buying lottery tickets? Have you ever waited behind somebody who is really into buying lottery tickets in specific numbers? Have you waited behind a person who is really into buying lottery tickets with specific numbers and believes that he has the winning ticket in his hand? But he doesn't? Ooh. And yet through all of that, Chris was just a picture of patience and kindness, right? We got to the checkout, and she checked us out, and it was awesome. And I said, "Can I take your picture?" She's like, "Are you weird or what?" Right? Thank goodness Michelle was right there with me, right? said, I'm a pastor, and I'm preaching on ways that we live out our faith this Sunday. Can I take your picture? And she paused for a second. She said, sure. And so she moved over to the door, and we grabbed her picture, right? Our new friend, Chris, who puts her faith in action, and in doing so, brings glory to God. This past week, I was talking to one of you. I was walking beside a young man who was 19 years old. And throughout his life, as a young man, he was, and child, he was abused. So much so that during this time frame, he has started to use drugs and alcohol and has made attempts on his life for suicide. And there you are. There you are telling me about this young man and how today at 19 years old, he has a pretty rough personality. Duh. When suddenly you start to cry. As you say, to be honest, it's a miracle the young man is still alive. And so you put your faith in action. You bring glory to God by simply making yourself available to this young man any time of day or night. He can call you and you can talk to him, and you do. Demonstrating over and over again what love looks like to this man that never experienced love in his life. I was talking to Mary Bettoni this week. Mary handles several different places at Maumee City Schools. She's over there, supervisor over the bus drivers and the buses, and also, I believe, supervisor over the food distribution. This during COVID and during the summer months, she makes sure that students who are hungry or have food scarcity issues in their lives are fed, her and her staff. To make sure that the children who just don't have enough to eat have enough to eat. And her team and herself are just amazing, working long hours to make sure through COVID that happened. And in the summer, already 150 students signed up that have food scarcity issues in their homes or signed up for lunches that they can come by the school and get. Mary and her staff, just like my friend who was working with that young man, have put their faith into action, not in complicated ways, but in simple ways, right, that are powerful and give glory to God. And finally, I was talking to Katie Glover this week. In fact, she called me yesterday out of the blue, said, I hear you're moving. I hear you're leaving. I said, yes, I am. I was afraid you'd come back and I'd have to live with you, so I'm out of here. No, I didn't tell her. I did not tell her that. But we do banter. I remember one time I was going to meet her in the office. And I made sure that the doors were unlocked because if you don't know Katie, she uses a motorized wheelchair to get around. And so I made sure the doors were unlocked. And we have like an automatic door opener at the Family Life Center so they can anybody who needs that can get into the building that way. And then I was in my office. I had opened this door in the office. And so I just waited. And it was like 15 minutes later, and she wasn't here. And I thought, well, maybe she's running late. And I thought, well, I'm gonna go check. And so I went down, and she's in the Family Life Center lobby. Her mom had dropped her off. She's in the Family Life Center lobby just waiting on me because I had forgotten to open the door that goes to the ramp, and she can't open the door that goes to the ramp. And so she was waiting on me. She's like, duh. I said, I'm sorry. And so I'm talking to her this week. She called to check in. And she shared how she was doing and talking about how through this experience of seminary, she is in seminary. I'm sorry, I don't think I said that. She's pursuing a double master's degree down at the Methodist Theological School in Ohio, down in Delaware. And she's just talking about, as she's been there, I think, 3 years now, how her focus is starting to change. She was certainly looking to be ordained in the United Methodist Church, but I think prior she was kind of looking at going into pastoral ministry, and now she's kind of shifted that focus into a more academic academic career of teaching. And so she was talking about that. I think, knowing Katie, we should just now start calling her Dr. Glover, because we will be eventually. We just might as well get used to that, right? But for you that don't know her or her journey. I can tell you that when she first started this journey of ordination and of seminary experience, it was one of those journeys that was a little bit more complicated, a little bit harder to say yes to, because there were so many things that had to happen before she could go, right? So Katie said it wasn't really one big yes, but it was a lot of little yeses along the way where God would meet her. She moved forward. The first yes was God opening the door for financial assistance that she would need to be able to afford this education. Or as she watched the doors that God opened in providing physical access to the places she needed physical access if she was going to go to that seminary. Physical access simply to get into her apartment, because there was a slight little step up, and then how do you get through the doorway if it's not smooth? And all of these things. How do you get into classes if they don't have an automatic door opener? All of those things that she has since helped the college or helped the seminary understand what it is to give resources to people who may not be able to have access to their seminary. Or even as God convinced her that he would be sufficient to find aides that would need to live with Katie. Aides not just would come and do a job and help her get ready and give her baths and all of that, but aides that truly loved her and would minister to her in a way that would promote life, right? Or God convinced her that he would provide for her in her mental challenges and in her physical challenges, and just the exhaustion of trying to type a paper one letter at a time very slowly. And now through speech, software has become so much better. And yet, after talking to Katie yesterday, I can honestly say each time I talk to her, it is just extraordinary to see how God is doing a work in her life. She's a different young lady than she was when she left here 3 years ago. It's amazing. She's become a witness of God's grace and power in her life, of brokenness in some senses, right? That have turned into this beautiful badge of honor that God just exemplifies and pushes out for all people to see. She continues to put her faith in action over and over again. And she will continue on this course if she goes into teaching to allow others to experience that over and over again, as she gives witness to God and his glory. Now, I close with one last example, even though I can go on and on. In fact, I grabbed somebody today and said, I could have used your story. If there's one thing about Mommy United Methodist Church that I've learned, when somebody new shows up, say, man, when we got here, we knew it was home, right? And the reason it's home is because truly, 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 people are continuing to put their faith in action in this place that brings God glory. Over and over again. I could go really to almost any of you sitting in the pew and pull out story after story after story of how you have done this and how you live this out. Not in a complicated matter, but just in a way of whoever's next in line that you start to serve. And when you don't do it right, when you fall, when you mess up, I guarantee what you do is to repent and God picks you back up and brushes you off, and you start again. That's the nature and the DNA of this church. You put your faith in action, and you bring glory to God. A few years ago, right after Easter, Michelle and I went on vacation. We were here at this church. It had been a busy time after Easter. It's always like that, or up through Easter, up through Lent. There were a lot of loose ends to take care of right before I left, and so I was up late the night before we left, and it was one of those 6 a.m. flights because they're cheap, right? And we're cheap, right? And so we got one of those 6 a.m. flights. And I can tell you, I was even driving to the airport thinking, oh, 2 hours of sleep, right? And I got to the airport. We checked in and got on the plane. I sat down and I'm like, ah. Oh. And it's right then the woman next to me say, hi, what's your name? I went, oh, Lord, not a Russ. Please, Lord, not a Russ, right? You know, it would have been very easy for me to just be cordial for a little while, let her take a pause and then close my eyes and put my head back, and she would get the message. She wasn't one of those ornery people like me. She would stop knocking, right? But I didn't. I stayed engaged with her, and we talked really for the entire flight until we landed, and then I was helping somebody get some suitcases out of the overhead bin, and I'd gotten, I think we had taken one travel on. Anyway, I was bending over, and she was next to the window, and as I was bending over, checking something, get it together, I was just about ready to leave the plane. She goes, "What do you do for a living?" Now, most of the time, I don't tell people what I do for a living, right? If it's going to be a while that I'm with them, I'll just say, I'm coming in an HR kind of field. And I say, oh, okay, you know. Because the second that I tell somebody I'm a pastor, it just completely changed the atmosphere. And it, like, sucks the air. Oh, you know. So I just kind of stay away from it, right? But seeing that we were about to get off, I looked at her and I said, well, I'm a pastor. And she immediately responds, well, that explains why you're so nice. And I just smiled. And I thought to myself, no, I am not nice. I am not nice because I'm a pastor. I am nice because I have allowed you to see and experience the person who lives in my heart. Right? At the end of the day, that is what picking up your mantle is all about. You are simply choosing to allow the person who is in front of you to see and experience Jesus who lives in your heart. And that will always, always, always bring glory to God. Amen? Amen. Will you pray with me? Heavenly Father, I know from experience that I try to complicate life. I think I'm going to go borrow that pudding label from Bethany, just to remind myself to keep things simple. Because the reality, Lord, is that you keep things simple for us. You're simply telling us in our journey after we receive our baton of faith to introduce me to your friends, to let people see who lives in your heart. And then you're telling us, and I'll do the rest of the work. Lord, help us to receive that invitation to pick up our mantle. And Lord, breathe life into that space. So that through your power, we might go out into this world, through the highways and through the byways, Lord, bumping into people left and right, introducing them to the person that lives in our hearts. And through that, Lord, we will give you all the praise and the glory. Praying this in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Would you please stand as you are able, and we will join together in our song of response, Take My Life and Let It Be. Take my life and let it be. Consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from Thee. Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour at thy feet its treasure store. Take myself, and I will be ever only all for thee.
You may be seated. So that song speaks of giving God our silver and our gold. And so that is our way of continuing the work of Christ Church, is through the giving of our resources. And so if you'd like to give here in person, there are baskets as you depart. If you're giving online, please do so at the Giving tab on the website, or mail your contribution to the church. Couple of announcements. The first is about our prayer quilts. So we started last week with those graduation quilts, actually inviting all of you to tie knots and pray for those individuals who are receiving them. And so that continues today with a very full rack of quilts for various individuals. So you're invited to take a moment and pray over one or more quilts, just being mindful and full of grace as we try not to crowd one another. Just so that you better understand, and we've not communicated maybe this very well, we stopped naming the quilts now that we are online, just to protect the privacy of the individuals receiving them. So a list describing the individuals and their circumstance for which they need prayer is available in the rack, the prayer quilt rack. All right, you're welcome to take those with you. And now, I move to a sad subject. This is Pastor Russ's last full week with us. Hear the silence? Okay. So the staff is having our final staff lunch together on Tuesday, and we are having a program that's been planned for a while, and it's remaining simply a live stream program. You're invited to tune in by going to the church website and going to where it says watch live. Just click on that at 7 o'clock on Tuesday, and you can be a part of that program, that the details of which are being kept from these two over here. Yes. And you also have had some other opportunities to express your grief and your well wishes. So we hope you've taken advantage of those. Next Sunday is Pastor Russ and Michelle's final Sunday with us. And following each service, you will have an opportunity to personally greet them, to bid them farewell, and give them your expressions of gratitude. So after each service, after this service, we will be lining up down the ramp, asking you to keep those expressions of your feelings to brief, so that we can all have a chance to say goodbye. After the 10:30 service, that'll be the same thing happening outside of the Family Life Center. We'll be lining up and being spaced to do that and keep everyone safe. Tissues will be on hand. Might buy stock this week. So let us pray. Lord, take our lives and let them be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take our moments and our days, our hands, our feet, our silver, our gold, our love, our hearts. Take our upcoming week and use us as vessels of grace for all those who have yet to know that their God who created them loves them beyond compare. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.